Good morning and welcome to the 29th meeting in 2022 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. I received apologies this morning from Colin Smith. So our first item of business is a decision to take item 3 in private. Are members content to do so? Thank you. So our next item of business is an evidence session with Richard Lockhead, Minister for Just Transition, Employment and Fair Work. And the purpose of today's evidence session is to discuss with the Minister the Scottish Government's Just Transition plans and progress, with the intention of us doing some future work on this. So I welcome Richard Lockhead, MSP, Minister for Just Transition, Employment and Fair Work, who is joined with Katrina Lang, Deputy Director for Climate Change Division, Scottish Government. If members and witnesses could keep their answers as short and concise as possible, that would be helpful. And I invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to the committee. I'm delighted to have my first opportunity to come along and speak to you in my role as Just Transition Minister, but also with responsibility for employment and fair work as well. So I look forward to this morning's engagement. And I'm pleased to have the opportunity just for a few opening remarks to try and set the scene from the government's perspective. And firstly to say that I think public understanding of Just Transition is hopefully increasing, but I think we all accept there's still a long way to go. And for me, a just transition is about the benefits to the Scottish economy, to jobs and skills, affordability, particularly clearly in this day and age for those least able to afford the changes we require in the years and decades ahead. It's also about tangible benefits for Scotland's communities and people. And it's about ensuring we achieve the fairest possible transition between now and our net zero targets of 2045. A just transition to net zero will be challenging, as all change is, and here in Scotland we've seen damage caused by rapid structural changes in the past. Many of our former coal mining communities, as you're all aware, are still feeling the impacts of what was inflicted on them 40 years ago. So we now have an opportunity, a fantastic opportunity, to harness Scotland's resources, and there's no doubt the opportunities we face are vast. To give a couple of examples, we have the potential to produce 5 gigawatts of hydrogen in Scotland by 2030 and 25 gigawatts by 2045. And to put that into context, 5 gigawatts of hydrogen is approximately 15% of current energy use in Scotland. Establishing Scotland as a leading producer and exporter of green hydrogen could also support up to 300,000 jobs and contribute up to £25 billion to Scotland's GVA by 2045 as well. And 31,000 jobs have already been created across the UK in offshore wind, and 30% of those jobs have been created in Scotland. So that's some signs of the progress that can be made and is being made. But at the heart of the Just Transition is the commitment to a planned and managed transition to net zero, as stressed by the first Just Transition Commission in its report. And having accepted the recommendations of the first GTC, we're now developing just transition plans for key sectors in Scotland. The energy strategy and just transition plan for energy will be published soon, and we will set out a roadmap for delivering on our energy ambitions for 2030 and lay out our vision for Scotland's future net zero energy system. We'll also develop a place-based plan for the Grangemouth energy cluster, working with important partners such as the Grangemouth Future Industry Board. And we're beginning to develop sectoral just transition plans for land and agriculture, transport, buildings and construction. And I can confirm today that we will be publishing outline plans for these three sectors next spring to support a period of intensive co-design on the policy detail for each of these sectors. These outline plans will include draft outcomes for each of the sectors, initial policy suggestions to work towards those outcomes, and will set some of the key issues that co-design will have to address. They will also set out an evidence base to underpin each of those plans. They will help deliver net zero in a way that's fair for all and ensure that the cost of the transition will not disproportionately burden those least able to pay. We've already expanded programmes like our Home Energy Scotland service to support those most impacted, for instance, by the cost crisis. So good planning can provide the certainty that communities and businesses and workers need during this period of change, and our approach to Just Transition puts co-design at the core of planning and policy. Over the summer, we engaged with almost 1,500 people to help develop our draft energy strategy and Just Transition plan. That included face-to-face workshops, surveys, digital dialogues and community events. And as I mentioned, we'll also be doing a huge period of engagement and co-design next year to support the development of the other just transition plans I mentioned are coming. So it's really, really important that people are able to shape these plans, as without societal buy-in, it will be impossible for us to reach net zero in a fair way. So finally, we also know that some parts of Scotland are already in the process of transitioning to emerging industries. This is most pronounced in the energy transition and especially the transition of our oil and gas industry. That industry has provided economic opportunity and high value, high quality employment for over 50 years in the Northeast specifically or especially, and it's become a vital cultural touchstone for many communities, not dissimilar to the role that coal mining played in many places across Scotland in past times. But again, it's a declining resource, and we have a profound and urgent responsibility to accelerate to the fastest possible just transition to protect opportunities for workers and bolster the regional and national economies. That's one of the reasons why we did launch our £500 million Just Transition Fund for the North East and Moray, with the first £50 million committed in September. So that includes large-scale transformational projects, community-level action, and crucially, the testing of concepts and technologies that may be rolled out in other parts of the country. It's helping finance organisations, businesses and communities and individuals to transition, creating jobs in low-carbon industries and supporting the provision of skills. So, in conclusion, Just Transition is a big, broad agenda. It's a learning experience about how to deliver a just transition in Scotland. We're learning as we go. And it's not always easy to shift from concept to delivery, but it's clear I do believe we are making progress. I'm focused on maintaining the pace and ambition of this agenda as we head into 2023, which will be a crucial year of delivery for a just transition to net zero. And I hope my opening remarks help put in context the challenges and opportunities we face, and I look forward to your comments and questions today.
Thank you very much, Minister. We do all have a shared ambition of meeting the goal for a just transition. The target is 2045, but you'll know the Climate Change Committee published a report this morning that expresses some concerns, recognises ambition in Scotland, but expresses concerns around progress. They do say that the Scottish Government lacks a clear delivery plan and there's not a coherent explanation for how policies can achieve targets, and express some concern about the ability to deliver on a transition which is fair and equitable unless the targets are being achieved. So while you don't have responsibility for the climate change targets, you do have responsibility for just transition. So I suppose it's looking for a response to the comments from the Climate Change Committee this morning, how you see that, the challenges that are set out, the impact that will have on what you're trying to do with in terms of just transition and sectoral plans. Given the significance of what has been said in the report this morning, is it you're looking at plans being published in spring? Is it an intention to review those plans, or you know, what impact does this have on the planning work that's already taken place?
So the Climate Change Committee's report is a clear signal of the urgent need for transformation in Scotland to achieve our targets. And that's transformation across our economy and society. And there are some strong messages in there for the Scottish Government in terms of the pace it's required to achieve our targets. There are, of course, some comments also in there in terms of the role of the Just Transition and some pointers towards the progress we are making in that area. And it highlights the needs, for instance, for the role of skills, in terms of meeting our net zero ambitions for energy and transport, construction, manufacturing and so on. It does recognise there's been some good progress in terms of some of the funds we've brought forward, in terms of the Green Jobs Fund, the Just Transition Fund, which I mentioned in the opening remarks as well, and the National Transition Training Fund that's been in place for some time also. Your question in terms of how we'll take into account those strong messages in the formation of our Just Transition plans is a good one, because we will have to take that into account, because we are, on the one hand, being told we have to go further, faster, and of course that's got an impact in the Just Transition debate, because that means the radical transformation of our economy in the years ahead has got to happen to achieve our targets. So what we will do next year is outline our plans for construction, agriculture and land use and transport, and also the place-based plan for Grangemouth, which alone is responsible for something like 8-10% of national emissions. And we'll then have a massive exercise across Scotland to ensure the actual detail of those plans and what's in them is co-designed with the communities most affected. But we will outline our initial plans to start off that debate in the spring of next year, and we'll take into account the need for being transformational.
And the energy plan, I think you said, is due soon, because that is a delayed plan. And I suppose it might not be your responsibility to answer this one, but there has been concerns that the plans so far have been quite high level and quite strategic. What we need to see is more detailed plans around delivery. So do you have any idea of the energy plan that is due and what level of delivery that will have in it? And then the plans that you're talking about publishing in the spring that will go to a co-producing kind of phase, how long do you anticipate that phase to last? Because I suppose the committee, you know, looking back, if you're looking at a 2045 target, you know, strategies and plans are, we understand the importance of them, but we do need to see action plans in place that will give delivery and make significant progress. So how long, once we get to, what is the energy plan likely to look like? And once we get to spring, how long will the co-design phase take until we can actually start to see some concrete delivery on the ground on these issues?
So we are aligning our just transition plans with the Scottish Government's next climate change plan. And that's because clearly the climate change legislation in the Scottish Parliament has a just transition reference in it, and we have to make sure we're taking into account all the issues we'll be discussing today. So we will, throughout 2023, in time for the draft climate change plan, which will be published, I understand, before the end of 2023, they're aligned together. And then clearly the climate change plan for Scotland has to be adopted a year or so later after the draft plan's published.
Mm. And so at this stage,
we're trying to align all of that. Mm-hmm. And in terms of the energy plan and its detail, the draft energy strategy, which will come out, will be a whole energy system approach. So there'll be quite significant detail in it. There will also be within that the just transition elements. Now, just transition, of course, is always evolving. So we will have an energy just transition plan alongside the refreshed energy policy. And we'll have as much detail as we can, but it's always evolving. So where we are in 2022, we, you know, are sowing seeds for hopefully transformation in the coming decades. So clearly the picture will always change, and it's got to be an evolving, living, breathing approach to just transition in Scotland as we become more aware of what's required for each sector. You know, there's such a myriad of opportunities for Scotland, like whether it's onshore wind, offshore wind, hydrogen, carbon capture, decarbonising buildings. So it's a massive exercise in terms of gearing up the skills system for that, in terms of where the appropriate funding's got to be, not just from the public sector, but the private sector. So it's got to be a living, evolving, breathing approach to just transition. Also with the fact we've not been through this before. So we have to continually learn lessons and adapt, see what's working, what's perhaps not working as well, and move our way forward.
Katrina, would you like to come in? Yeah.
Thank you. Just to add one or two points to what the Minister is saying, I think it's important that to note that the previous climate change plan update did not have proper measurement and evaluation of the impact of the different activities that were set out in the plan. And one of the big challenges of the climate change plan coming up towards the end of next year is that we do have an obligation to set out those measurements and impacts. Scottish Government's ambitions in this space are rightly one of the most ambitious in the world. And I think we're also ahead of many countries in terms of challenging ourselves on those issues. So we are actually, we've asked a company called Ricardo to do an assessment of how well we are doing in terms of impact already. And those results, we will be publishing those quite soon. And they will be challenging results. But what that does is it allows us to respond as early as possible in a an atmosphere where this is a crisis, so that we know how much more we have to do to succeed in reaching our targets. And then there will be an iterative process. So, as the Minister rightly says, the just transition plans are a key have a key relationship with the climate change plans, and being able to consult on them is partly about understanding what the Scottish Government needs to do, but it's also about ensuring that the whole of Scotland understands what it has to do as well. As this is being a whole national Scotland approach, we need the private sector, we need communities, we need the voluntary sector, we need our own government to come together and collaborate on these issues.
I mean, we're in a situation where, you know, this morning they're saying that Scotland has lost its lead over the rest of UK on tackling climate change. We are, in some extent, going backwards. We've been overtaken. We did have high ambitions, and we were making significant progress. That is starting to stall, and I think there are areas where we, you know, it doesn't need a strategy to work out some of the simple things we need to do that we're just not seeing progress on. But I'm going to go to Graham Simpson, who's got some questions in some of these areas, and then I'll move on to Fiona Hislop.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good to see you. But before I ask, I'm going to ask some questions around about the Climate Change Committee's report this morning. But I just want to pick up on something you mentioned earlier. You said there'd be a specific Grangemouth plan. And I just wondered when we're likely to see that.
Yeah. So that'll be a place-based plan, yeah. And that will be published alongside the other plans I mentioned in the spring. It'll be very much an outline at that stage, because we then want to take forward that exercise of co-design. And Grangemouth, as you'll be aware, is responsible for a lot of emissions, but there's a lot of potential for the role to evolve of Grangemouth, the complex there, in terms of hydrogen and biotechnology and so on. And of course, in terms of industrial emissions alone, Grangemouth's got an important role to play.
Okay, so we'll see that along with the others probably by the end of June, I would imagine, next year. So looking at the Climate Change Committee report, it's pretty damning. They've actually published a table which is quite useful. So if we just go through it, on transport, no new fossil car sales by 2030, slightly off track, 20% reduction on 2019 car kilometres by 2030, that's a Scottish Government policy, significantly off track. Low carbon heat, too early to say. Energy efficiency, significantly off track. Afforestation, slightly off track. Peatland restoration, significantly off track. Recycling rates, significantly off track. So if this was a school report for you, Minister, you'd be kept in after school, wouldn't you?
Well, I genuinely, notwithstanding the significant challenges highlighted by the report, believe we are approaching in the next few years many different tipping points in terms of the transformation of the Scottish economy. You just have to look at the news of the last few days, and there's various projects being announced to create new green jobs and to make a contribution towards decarbonising Scotland. But I absolutely accept, and the government accepts, that, you know, we have spent a lot of time, quite rightly, putting in place the frameworks, the funding, the policies, and now it's about delivery, and that's the clear message from the report, is it's now about delivery, and we have to go on with actually delivering. There's a lot of work taking place across government to get to the point of actual delivery so we can start achieving many of those targets.
Okay, I'm going to focus on transport because, as you know, that's the biggest emitter of carbon. The Just Transition Commission, they focus on transport as well, but if I can, so in fact they say Scotland's public transport network requires vast improvement and must be made more affordable. They talk about ScotRail capacity needing to be expanded, not reduced, expanded. And then if we go on to the report that's come out today, the Climate Change Committee is saying plans to decarbonise transport in Scotland are falling behind. Scotland has a laudable aim to reduce car kilometres by 20% on 2019 levels. It's a challenging goal, but current plans lack a full strategy. There isn't a strategy. There are no policies in place to achieve that, are there?
Well, the Scottish Government's allocated £2 billion towards transport projects in this agenda. Over £1 billion for rail electrification, £500 million towards active travel, £50 million towards active freeways, £287 million in the Future Transport Fund, £495 million in bus priority investments, £120 million in zero-emission buses, etc. So a lot of the building blocks have been put in place in the transport agenda, but I think in the last two or three years, we've seen various factors come into play that we were not expecting. So we saw the impact of COVID, where on the one hand, transport emissions fell in terms of certain sectors because of lockdown, but now we find that people are reluctant to go back to public transport and are still driving. And, you know, so some of these left field issues have come into play that have affected our emissions in the transport sector, particularly in terms of cars. So, you know, we don't underestimate the challenges, and this is about behavioural change as much as government's policies. It's about everyone. It's about private sector, public sector. It's about political consensus. I recall in the Scottish Parliament the battle we had from the Members' Party and other parties over car parking and private business car parking charges and levies, and giving local authorities the powers that other parts of the UK have, and it became a political battle. So what I'd say to the member and the committee is that we need a bit of political consensus, and we want to put in some really game-changing measures. If they just turn into political battles all the time, even though we're all supposed to be signed up to going towards net zero and reducing transport emissions, that political consensus really help us.
Well, except you're not the Transport Minister. The Transport Minister has my phone number. She can ring me any time, and she knows I'm prepared to work with her on all these matters. My door is open, if hers is. If we just stick to transport, and I know you're not the Transport Minister, but your brief covers
everything,
a lot of areas. If we want to get people out of, away from driving petrol and diesel cars, then something else has to be in place. And it's either we persuade them to use public transport more, and or use vehicles that are not powered by petrol and diesel, so let's say electric vehicles. Now, we're doing quite well with the charging network, but there's a long way to go. We've got 2,400 charging places at the moment. The aim is to have 30,000 in the next 7 years. There's a long, long way to go. And as we know, many of them don't work. There's an unreliability factor there, which is not going to persuade people to switch to electric vehicles. So do you accept there's a real challenge there? And do you accept that despite the progress we've made, that we need to do better on electric vehicles?
Yes, every part of this debate we discussed today will be a massive challenge for Scotland and for society, given what we're facing and what we have to do in the coming decades between now and 2030 and now in 2045. I think it's fair to say there have been reports out saying that Scotland's got the second best electric car charging points infrastructure in the UK outside of London, and you know, and other parts of the UK are trying to catch up, and of course we have to do better, as the member says. So I do accept, of course, we've got to do better, and I do accept this is a massive challenge. But we, again, are making progress in that agenda as well. We're trying to achieve in the next few decades the transformation of our economy and our society. But where we got to today took several hundred years, and we're trying to cram equivalent transformation into the next two or three decades. So it is a big challenge. And all I can say is that some of these changes that we'd require to reduce Our emissions in Decarbonise Scotland are so challenging that we just need to have that political consensus to support these measures.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay. Just before I bring in Ms Hislop, you deferred to green jobs. It was just asking for an update on, there's been debate around definition of a green job. There was ONS issues raised in the autumn around what defines a job, how do we measure this? So I'd just like to know where the government are up to on this.
Yeah, well, it's a good question and it's a pet subject of mine because understandably we'd be criticised when the ONS were publishing their green jobs statistics, despite the fact we were aware there was many green jobs being created in Scotland. Now the ONS have accepted that their definition requires to be updated and they're currently reviewing their definition. So hopefully we'll have a more accurate definition. However, we have also seen independent research carried out by Skills Development Scotland working with Warwick University and Strathclyde University. They published a report just a few weeks ago, which the committee, I'm sure, would be very interested in, which says that at the moment in Scotland there's up to, I mean it may be less, but it's up to 100,000 green jobs in Scotland, mm-hmm. and they've explained the definitions in there.
So is that the definition that the government's, because you must have a working definition if you're setting targets for green jobs,
so
that is different from
the difficulty
ONS,
is there's no uniform definition across the UK, across the world, and the ONS has said are looking at this as the official statistics body.
Mm-hmm.
There's also, they're looking at different categories. So they're looking at green jobs that are created in emerging sectors, but also existing jobs that are being greened.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the understandable challenges is a job nowadays may involve part of its time being a green job. And do you define that as a green job or not a green job? Because it might not be 100% of the employee's time doing green tasks.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just a sign of the fact that the world of work's changing and you know the green economy's emerging. So these are the sort of challenges that ONS and others are looking at. But I think it's good news that we now have a report that says there's up to 100,000 green jobs in Scotland. And many of those are in new emerging sectors.
Okay, so other members may wish to pick this up, but I'll bring in Fiona Hislop.
Yes, Minister, you referred to carbon capture and storage. The Net Zero Committee, which I also sit on, produced a report into the ACORN project and carbon capture utilisation storage earlier this year and made clear that it was a key energy transition requirement, but obviously it's been put on pause. During that session, Professor Hazeldine said that, that it would require a five-year lead-in for building such a project and it needed to be in operation by 2030. And he also then went on to say, so deciding now how we are going to handle that is fundamental to Scotland being able to meet or failing to meet its 2045 net zero target. And clearly we've got a very critical report come out from the Climate Change Committee, but that project has been said by the Climate Change Committee to be vital and critical to delivering these very tough targets. So bearing in mind the location of that project in the northeast of Scotland, bearing in mind that we're here to focus on just transition, which is about obviously you know, the workforce and communities, and this is a transition technology that would help that bridge in a vital area for workforce skills from oil and gas to green hydrogen as a bridging technology. Can you tell us where we are with that project and how critical it is to delivering a just transition for Scotland?
Well, I thank Fiona Hislop for raising that question because it's very pertinent to the Climate Change Committee's report today, and it does remind us that many of the decisions to get to our net zero targets lie with the UK government taking the right decisions and not just the Scottish government, because we don't have all the powers over all the issues, obviously. And it's worth also saying that the ACORN project is not just a project for North East Scotland, it's also relevant to Grangemouth, for instance, which we discussed recently. It's an absolutely crucial project. And as Ian Wood said, if I remember correctly, not giving the go-ahead for Track 1 status for the ACORN project in Scotland is like a football team leaving its best player on the bench. I'm not sure if Portugal did that last night, because they actually get quite a good score, despite doing that. But the principle, of course, is an absolute valid one, because this is a project which is vital for Scotland to achieve its net zero ambitions, but not just Scotland, the rest of the UK as well, as Fiona Hislop says. I was actually at a meeting of the North Sea Transition Forum in London a few days ago, and that forum is chaired by the UK Minister, and I attend it as well on behalf of the Scottish Government. And of course, everyone had travelled down from Aberdeen, but unfortunately, the UK Minister had to go and answer an urgent question, so wasn't actually at the meeting. So we had an Aberdeen gathering in London. That's one of the things we have to deal with. But someone said at that meeting that we are in danger of making the same mistakes we've made before, where we have a massive opportunity to do the right thing, create jobs, new industries, but we're taking too long to take the decisions, and we may lose and not be first mover, and other countries will get ahead of us. Now, this has to be treated with a lot more urgency by the UK government. We have to get the Acorn project given the go-ahead. It is critical. The Scottish Government has put £80 million on the table to help meet some of the demands of the project, to try and work with the UK government to get the go-ahead for the Acorn project. There's constant correspondence and communication between Michael Matheson and the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero, and indeed I think Deputy First Minister as well, with the UK government on the issue of Acorn. So I do hope that soon we can get the green light for that. I've actually got a photo on my phone, and I want to show the committee, of me standing after a recent visit to the St Fergus gas terminal next to the pipeline, standing next to the pipeline that's ready to take about 30%, if I recall correctly, of Scotland's industrial emissions down that pipeline and store it in an empty reservoir, recycling part of the oil and gas industry's infrastructure to the Golden Eye field. And, you know, we just can't get the go-ahead. And we have the infrastructure in Scotland ready to use. We're ahead of the rest of the UK in that regard. We've got the academic expertise also based in Scotland. And therefore, it's vital. But final point to make is, of course, the jobs point of this, which is the just transition part of it as well, which is that we were told that from 2022 onwards, we could create up to 15,000 jobs. 15,000 jobs, getting up to about 20,000 jobs by 2030. And that is a lot of jobs. And if you look at how many jobs are in the oil and gas industry in the northeast of Scotland, for instance, just now, that's a big percentage of what we've got in oil and gas at the moment. So this is about jobs, and it's about achieving our net zero targets.
And just very briefly, and it might help with our discussion, my colleagues just asked about transport, I've asked about energy. You're not the lead Minister or Cabinet Secretary, particularly in those areas, and you're our first ever Just Transition Minister. I think it would be helpful if you could maybe explain how you do work with other ministers in other areas, and what levers do you have to influence and push the agendas that we know will be critical to deliver just transition in areas that you might not have a direct responsibility for?
So, as you can imagine, because obviously it's a vital question in terms of delivering a just transition, we are mainstreaming just transition through all portfolios and all policies. So, I have bilateral meetings and correspondence with all other cabinet secretaries and ministers. And we discuss clearly, you know, the urgency of, in the case of transport or other areas, that we support the just transition. So all ministers at the moment are working on the just transition dimensions of their own responsibilities. And clearly my responsibility is to help coordinate that, but also coordinate the publication of the plans. So, you know, my officials will kind of coordinate the publication of the plans, but clearly the different teams across government and ministers have got the responsibility for actually populating those plans and the measures we'll take.
Thank you, Camille.
Okay, thank you. Micah Chapman.
Thanks very much, Claire, and good morning. Thank you for what you've said so far and for being here this morning. Clearly, as you said, we have ambitious targets to meet in Scotland, but that's part of a bigger picture of, you know, the idea of what we hear termed as keeping 1.5 degrees alive. And that rapid shift and pace of transition has to happen, as you've mentioned, with engagement and conversations with workers around job creation and that broader energy and economy shifts. We'll get into some of the details around maybe some of the specific community issues when we talk about the Just Transition Fund for the North East and Murray a little bit later. But I want to, thinking about the economy more generally, how is it that we can ensure that we future-proof the work that we're doing and we don't lock in disadvantage, we don't lock in inequality. You mentioned in your opening remarks that the previous energy transition we went through has left mining communities still suffering. How do we make sure that we don't lock in that disadvantage and we actually use this to ensure we work on equality, we make it fairer for people now who aren't maybe reaping the benefits of the oil economy that we've had for the last 50 years.
Yeah. Your question goes to the heart of what the just transition is all about. And when people ask me what's the just transition, I'm very keen to always emphasise that as we go through the economic transformation to decarbonise Scotland in the decades ahead, that we use that as a window of opportunity to not repeat past mistakes and to tackle inequalities. Because after all, if you're going to rebuild and redesign your economy, you want to make it better for everyone and you want to tackle inequality. So that really is at the heart of the just transition, and co-design is a very important principle. So I'm always emphasising to any community I visit, to organisation I meet, public sector, private sector, that, and I know there's a lot more to do, that any policies put in place or projects that are coming forward, they should be co-designed with the local communities. And we want to know that it has buy-in. And of course, we've got the wider challenge of who pays for the just transition. Mm-hmm. And that's why the government, in terms of its use of public sector funding, is ensuring we support people on low incomes, whether it's with retrofitting their homes, tackling fuel poverty. You'll be aware of various funds being brought forward to support people on low incomes and who are the hardest hit. Overall, of course, we want to ensure that everyone benefits from the just transition and the prosperity that's available to us and the tackling fuel poverty through deploying Scotland's massive energy resources is going to be a key outcome, for instance, of the next few years, especially in light of the current energy crisis and cost of living crisis. We live in an energy-rich country, yet people are paying through the nose for energy bills. So if we look back in, 10 years, 20 years, and people are still paying through the nose for energy in a country that's producing several times what we require for energy, then the just transition will have failed.
Yeah.
And I'm very upfront about those tests. A lot of work and challenges getting there, but we have to aim for that. We cannot live in an energy-rich country where people are fuel poor, and that's a test of the just transition.
And I suppose that actually links to Fiona's question around the working across portfolios, working between and across departments. One of the, I think there's been quite a lot of discussion or quite a lot of talk around, using a mission-based approach or a challenge-based approach that doesn't get siloed into different departments. What are the challenges within the way the Scottish Government and the Parliament more generally works that you, in your view, we need to actually change in the next decade if we're not only to meet targets, to do all the things we want to do, but to actually ensure that we are getting that cross-cutting work that means we don't fail on the equalities measures, never mind the energy measures?
So the mainstreaming aspect I mentioned earlier is really important. That policies can't work in silos or be developed in silos. We have to take into account what the impact is, on everyone, and to ensure that we don't place a disproportionate burden on any part of our communities. And we discussed the climate change report, climate change committee report earlier in the session, and the challenge it lays down. And of course, the solutions to many of those challenges are quite radical in terms of how we bring people with us in Scotland, of some of the measures that potentially would have to be taken. Mm-hmm. And if you look at decarbonising heatings and the work that Patrick Harvey's doing, which is one of the biggest pillars of the net zero journey, is how do we decarbonise Scotland's buildings and tackle those emissions. Clearly, the public sector cannot pay for that alone. If we're estimating that it's going to cost over £30 billion to decarbonise our heating in our buildings, and the government's brought forward a very ambitious £1.8 billion for the course of this Parliament towards that, which is a very substantial budget, but it's, in the context of the £30 billion by 2030, or give or take, we know it's got to be the public and the private sector have got to play a role as well, so that's a big challenge. And we, in terms of the just transition, have to ensure those least able to pay are not left with a disproportionate burden to pay for that. So we have to support people in that context.
Okay, thanks. And I suppose that's even before we start to talk about the costs of adaptation, but I know other people want to talk about finance, so I'll leave it there for now. Thanks.
Thank you. Before I move to Michelle Thompson, who has got some questions on finance, it's just going back to Fiona Hislop's question around your role within government. As part of the conversations you have with other cabinet secretaries and ministers, do you set expectations on where you expect to see progress, or do you have an idea of areas that should be prioritised? Is it your role to kind of set some of those parameters and encourage that kind of activity?
So clearly I'm working, and my officials are working, to ensure that the various policy teams across government are now working in the just transition. So there's a lot of work going on just now, coordinating the work for the plans we mentioned earlier, that the outlines will be published for next spring. So that's happening, and that's obviously my team are instigating that. I also sit on a lot of the various subcommittees. I mean, the main subcommittee is the Climate Change Subcommittee, so as Just Transition Minister, I sit on that, and clearly I'm there to bring the just transition dimension to that as we discuss some of those policies that are required to achieve our targets, and I'm also there to represent the just transition dimension of that debate. Obviously, as well as being Minister for Just Transition and Employment, I'm Employment and Fair Work, and all of that's got a just transition element to it as well. So as we tackle inequalities moving forward, we have to make people get good jobs, not just green jobs, but good green jobs. So in terms of the economic dimension of the government's work, I'm feeding in the just transition dimension to that as well, which is to make sure people are well paid.
So the reports that are coming out in spring, which are for co-design, will they, though, include these other priority areas? Will there be, you know, be clear indicators of this is the activity that needs to be prioritised to make differences, even though I recognise it will be co-design, will there still be a kind of direction in there about this is really what we need to do at this kind of timescale?
Clearly they're not written yet, so I can't preempt everything they'll say, but if you take skills, each of those plans will have to have a skills pillar in it. And, you know, skills is vital for all of these areas going forward to make sure people are upskilled, reskilled, and so on. And so that will be in every plan, and that's obviously crucial. So in terms of milestones, in terms of actions taken to make sure we are meeting the skills needs, there will be in each plan, to give one example.
Okay. We'll move on to some questions around finance. So I'll bring in Maggie Chapman, and I think Fiona Hislop has a question in this area. Sorry, Michelle Thompson. That was my apologies. And then I think Fiona Hislop has a question in this area, and Maggie Chapman, but I'll go to Michelle first.
Okay, good morning, Minister. Thank you for attending today. But before I go into some specific questions, I just wanted to kind of take it up a level. And there are a multitude of figures being bandied about exactly how much finance is required to enable a just transition and some of the changes we need to see. And they are quite eye-watering, and it's generally agreed that globally we're nowhere near it. But looking in a Scottish context, the Climate Change Committee report, I also noted, pointed out that many relevant powers related to areas such as funding, finance and product standards are reserved. So my question to you is, are you getting the support you need from the UK government to supply the level of funding requirements? Or are you having to take it out of the fixed Scottish budget, which obviously has very near-side time parameters in terms of planning? How's the kind of funding that you're able to realise being managed and actualised?
One of the biggest challenges is how we're going to fund the just transition and all the steps we have to take to get to net zero. And, you know, as the member says, a lot of the different figures for different policy areas or the global figures are eye-watering. On the one hand, in terms of COP26 in Glasgow, there was clear signals there are enormous amounts of private sector finance available around the world. So the Scottish Government is taking steps to try and attract that to be invested in Scotland. I actually remember one man standing behind me in the coffee queue in Glasgow who was boasting to his colleague that he had $2 billion available to invest, and I always regret not getting his business card and following up. But there was a lot of talk at COP26 about the amount of private sector finance available. Now, the UK government are doing their own green finance strategy, and the Scottish government submitted to that through the kind of consultation period. And I think our concern with the UK government would be pace. We need, this is urgent, and we need pace from the UK government, not just in areas like CCS and giving the Go Ahead to Acorn project, which would create an enormous amount of wealth for the Scottish economy and bring in private finance, but also in terms of the green finance initiative that the UK government are looking at. We need quick action on that. And in terms of the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government's budgets, we're all familiar with the pressures on public finance at the moment. So not only do we face these massive challenges of achieving net zero, we're doing it at a time when public budgets are under such huge pressure, and the current cost of living crisis and inflationary dimension to what's happening just now. And the government doesn't have borrowing powers to finance some of these major projects that's required. So we do need the UK government to step in where they can. And, you know, we've challenged them, for instance, to match the Scottish government's £500 million just transition fund over 10 years for North East Scotland and Moray. We would like to see a UK contribution to that. I think the Green Jobs Task Force the UK had a year or two back suggested that kind of finance is required from the UK government, and it's not been forthcoming. So there's a big role for the UK to play here.
So you've given a lot of flavour to that, and it's potentially one route to be given more money, but are you hearing the calls from across the Scottish Parliament for vastly increased borrowing powers for the Scottish Government, like any normal government who might want to undertake ambitious policies, so that we can crowd in private sector funding? Because that's the obvious, we all agree that no government's going to be able to fund this regardless, and it will need to crowd in private sector funding. So, I mean, in your private discussions, you may not be able to disclose it, are you hearing agreed calls from across this Parliament for extra borrowing powers to do this sort of activity?
No, I'm not hearing that enough. It would be great to have a political consensus that not only can we agree in the major steps that have to be taken to transform Scotland's economy in the years ahead, but we need the powers to do that.
Yep.
If we're going to be held to account for not implementing radical transformational projects, we need to have the support of all parties to have the powers to do that in the first place. Borrowing powers, and clearly there's other constitutional debates taking place just now, but borrowing powers is the obvious example. We had political unity and consensus. And you know, the more I think about it and talk about it, the more I realise how important it is, political consensus, because we've got many examples of what would be seen as, yes, important issues, but not necessarily the big issues we're going to have to deal with. But even they become huge storms in the Scottish Parliament and political battles. We have to have more of a political national consensus about what needs to be done if we want to save the planet and get to our net zero targets and save humankind and civilization, and that's what we're facing. Yeah. You know, Maggie Chapman mentioned keeping the temperature increased to below 1.5 degrees, but you know, some people are talking about 4 degrees by the end of the century, which has major ramifications for our children, our grandchildren, great-grandchildren. So if we want to tackle these issues, we need more political consensus.
Yeah, and matching ambition in terms of financial enablement. I noticed just, I've got a couple of final questions in the Climate Change Committee. They actually calls out risks due to where it's existing responsibilities, risk due to UK government action, oblique inaction around low carbon heat in existing homes. And they make that comment about details of market-based mechanisms and associated funding and so on. I do want to explore a wee bit more about the £500 million fund that you've already mentioned and get a bit more flavour about not just the funding, but how you're able to release that and to protect that, given the constraints and the real terms cut in the Scottish budget. Can you give us a bit more flavour to that, to understand some of the challenges even within that fund?
Well, the government's committed to delivering the £500 million fund over 10 years. The first year, £20 million allocated. However, many of the projects that came forward are multi-year projects. We've actually committed up to £50 million up to the next 4 years. Because some of the projects will account for that extra money. And the Scottish Government will bring forward its budget in the next few weeks in terms of the next year's funding for the Just Transition Fund. So we are committed to that, and you know, we've no plans to change that. Yeah, there's challenges because that's capital funding, and you know, I'm sure many of the projects may require revenue funding, and you know, we can only do what we can do, and therefore we've got a capital budget, and we're using financial transactions and capital budgets. But yeah, so there's always challenges because there's just not enough resource to achieve what people want to achieve, and you know, we need the UK government, Scottish governments, and the private sector as well as the public sector to all play their role.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm going to allow members who've already had questions to come in again, but if I ask you to keep the questions short, that would be helpful. So Fiona Hislop and then Maggie Chapman.
Yeah, I also wanted to ask about the £500 million Just Transition Fund for the North East and Moray, and obviously there have been projects already announced, and I absolutely understand the importance of having community cooperation and co-design and projects coming from the communities, but you know, and every single one of those 24 projects are worthy in and of themselves. But it might be a fair criticism to say that they might be very piecemeal based on challenge funding, and that there might be a need for a more strategic approach for such a significant element of funding. So how are you balancing out the worthiness of each individual project, but some of them are for private companies that may be able to finance these things themselves? And how are you then making sure that this is a really strategic impact that will deliver just transition as opposed to support individual projects? And I think that's a tension, I understand that. So can you maybe share a bit of your thinking about the funding mechanism process and your approach on that? That's my question, Camina.
Well, again, it's a good question, and it's something we've wrestled with, because on the one hand, we want to get the fund underway. We don't have time to wait several years for the perfect plans for the future, especially when it's an evolving situation. And we therefore chose the route of no regret decisions, i.e. each decision will contribute in its own way, therefore they're good projects. And there's a different, there's large projects, smaller projects, community projects, strategic projects, science projects, skills projects. There's a good basket of what's required for the just transition in the years ahead. But we are intending on using the next 2 or 3 years to develop that more strategic approach. Mm-hmm. Now, what we are funding fits in just now with the direction of travel, whether it's hydrogen or whatever, and obviously plugging the skills gaps that are required to be addressed in the years ahead. So we're confident all the projects are robust, good projects will contribute towards a just transition, but we know we have to work in the case of that fund with the North East and Moray over the strategic robustness that's required and to make sure it is transformational. We have to ensure that when we look back in 10 years' time that we've spent or invested £500 million of public money in transformation. And that's a big challenge. But some of the projects will be transformational, hopefully, and we'll look back and they'll have benefited not just the northeast of Scotland, but the rest of the country as well.
Thank you.
Maggie Chapman, and then I'll bring in Colin Beattie, who is going to ask questions around other issues, but Maggie, on finance.
I thought you were going to give me a warning there.
Thanks, Claire. Just following on from Fiona's question around some of the allocations of the Just Transition Fund, obviously that's key to us even having any hope of achieving our targets. But I am concerned, and others, particularly communities in the North East, are concerned that millions of pounds has already been allocated to large companies, often backed by the fossil fuel industry, that has seen record profits in recent months. And we've seen just £4.2 million allocated over 4 years to community-led participatory budgeting. And I think one of the clear concerns that it's not enough for money to be given to companies, and to call it a just transition, it actually needs to be genuine. And I'm not sure that we're going to get that unless we have that strategic work that Fiona alluded to. But two specific projects. We know that $14 million has been awarded to a contentious project in Torrey. You'll be very, very well aware of that. Torrey is a community to the south of Aberdeen that has some of the lowest life expectancy in Scotland and over a decade lower than other parts of the city. It hasn't benefited at all from the oil and gas economy. In fact, Old Torrey was bulldozed for the oil and gas economy. And I think there's a very, very clear mismatch in what we term justice here. If communities like the Torrey community have their only remaining green space concreted over for something that will assist the broader just transition, but that's not justice for those communities, so that community. So how do we tackle that kind of injustice, I think, if we don't have that dedicated focus to that community leadership, which we haven't seen in the current allocations?
Thank you. And it's a good challenge to put to the government and indeed the local economic partnerships involved. As a backdrop, I've been clear since day one, speaking to organisations, public sector groups, community groups in North East Scotland, that if, for instance, we have what is a vital project for North East Scotland, which is the energy transition, and part of that is the energy transition zone and the development of Aberdeen Harbour, but yet the neighbouring communities don't see the benefits, then the just transition will have failed in those areas. And I've been very clear about that since day one. And I understand in terms of the energy transition zone plans, there's been some good community engagement recently, and community residents are involved in some of the future plans now for that area. So I hope that is productive and makes progress. We have not funded any oil or gas companies directly. You can't support the development of the North East economy without involving the offshore sector and oil and gas industry.
I appreciate that.
And they are a crucial part of the just transition. They've got the skills, the expertise, the investments that are going to underpin the just transition, and we need their buy-in and to work with the oil and gas industry as it transitions over the coming decades. Because irrespective of net zero policies, employment in oil and gas in Aberdeen, North East Scotland is going to decline by 2040 and 2050 substantially. So the transition is super important in terms of the economic future. They are therefore part of the local economic partnerships, and we will work with these economic partnerships. So we've just got to be careful that there's no just transition funding that was announced going directly to oil and gas companies. We are supporting some economic partnerships, of which the oil and gas sector clearly have to be part of going forward.
Okay, thanks. Can I have one more?
Just brief,
just another project. One of the ambitions, or one of the pieces of work that the Scottish Government has underway at the moment, is an independent review of how to cut climate pollution from Scotland's existing incinerators. And you'll know that the Ness incinerator in Aberdeen was awarded some money from the Just Transition Fund to research feasibility around carbon capture and storage. Putting aside the fact that CCS has never been used successfully on an incineration plant anywhere in the world, I'm just curious as to whether you see there's a preemption there of the Scottish Government's commission into how to cut carbon emissions from incinerators. If we are saying actually we're going to fund an incinerator essentially to bake in or to bake in demand for waste generation.
So clearly, when we put out the call for bids for projects under the fund, each application was looked at under its own merits, and Scottish Government officials liaised with local authority officials, Scottish Enterprise in the area, to look at each project and which would be worth supporting. And we have to support emerging new technologies in some cases to find out what contribution they'll make. And so I don't think it preempts anything. I think it's just a straightforward funding of an innovative technology. As I said before, we want to see successes from the fund in North East Scotland and Moray that will benefit the rest of Scotland as well. We want to roll out some of the successes that are developed and discovered and innovated in North East Scotland to benefit other parts of Scotland. So it's a great place to have a laboratory for the just transitions North East Scotland because of the presence of the oil and gas and fossil fuel sectors which have to transition. So we have to support and trial different technologies.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Just before I bring in Colin Beattie, in terms of finance, we do have Scottish Enterprise, who are our main enterprise agency, and the Scottish National Investment Bank that were set up with a focus on renewables. So could you maybe say a bit about how these two agencies, what they are doing in terms of drawing in finance to Scotland, and if there's been a reprofiling, or, you know, what extent is this a priority within Scottish Enterprise? Are you able to comment on that at all?
Well, I do recall the Scottish Investment Bank are funding some just transition projects or decarbonising projects in Scotland. I don't have the list in front of me. So they are playing the role, and they've got a big responsibility to support net zero transition. And it's important to say that across the board, our enterprise companies, the Scottish National Investment Bank, are all signed up to prioritising the transition to net zero. So they are playing a role. And in peatland restoration and in other areas, they're playing a role as well. So,
be something we follow up with the relevant minister. We do take evidence from the Scottish National Investment Bank, but the Scottish Enterprise, would maybe the committee will look for more information on what we...
Yeah, they're making some substantial investments into projects about decarbonising certain sectors. I don't have the list in front of me because it's not my direct responsibility, but
appreciate that.
They are on, you know, they're playing a role, and they'll have to do more and more of that in the future. I think Katrina's maybe wanted to hear...
So just on the Scottish National Investment Bank, they do have £110 million currently allocated to the net zero transition. And on Scottish Enterprise, we have a kind of a different relationship with them depending on funding, but we do work with them very closely. So across the energy funds and across the climate change funds, some of those funds are managed more in-house, but with close collaboration with Scottish Enterprise, and Just Transition Fund is one of them. Scottish Enterprise do actually run for the Scottish Government a range of energy funds. I think as part of the resource spending review, we committed to moving from a funding to finance approach, and it touches on several of the questions we've already had in terms of how we work best to attract funding. So, of course, we know that, as others have said, that there are eye-watering amounts of money that need to be put in, but there are also some massive opportunities, of course, for the private sector and for businesses. And what we need to do is to be able to work closely with them so that we're unlocking some of those opportunities in partnership. And I think it's fair to say that we've got more work to do to maximise that. And I think our partners in Scottish National Investment Bank and Scottish Enterprise will be really key in terms of making that work as well as possible.
Thank you, that's helpful. Colin Beattie to be followed by Jamie Harcourt-Johnson.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Minister. Clear policy is extremely important to support emerging markets such as hydrogen, which are important to my constituency. What policy measures do you see need to be in place over the coming years in order to ensure that our businesses are equipped to be successful in these markets?
So, as I said earlier on, the potential of hydrogen in the future is potentially enormous for the Scottish economy and playing its role in decarbonising our country. I've spoken to people who think that Scotland could be one of the top three countries in the world in terms of a decarbonised economy if we play our cards right in the years ahead. So I hope that's true, because we've got a wealth of resources that could make that happen, but of course there's massive challenges and costs in getting there. So in terms of hydrogen, we have to, and the Scottish Government will be publishing its hydrogen statement policy in the next few weeks, and clearly be, that'll give you the committee an outline of the direction of travel for realising the potential of hydrogen for Scotland in terms of domestic roles and also export as well. And, you know, the initial assessment says up to 300,000 jobs, but clearly it could be anywhere between, you know, several tens of thousands and 300,000 jobs. So we will learn as we go over the next few years about the potential of hydrogen. In terms of the policy we have to put in place, clearly, you know, again, the skills. We have to make sure that people are upskilled and retrained to deal with hydrogen. There's a lot of work going on in Scotland in the private sector as well. I mean, SGN, Scottish Gas Networks, I received a presentation from them a month or two back. They're doing some incredible things in this space to investigate and explore what has to be done to re-engineer the infrastructure to take hydrogen and what would be required to do that and what, you know, that would mean for supply chains and skills and everything else. So they've, you know, there's a lot of work taking place in the private sector, but the commercial opportunities of this as well.
I mean, hydrogen is obviously only one area. There are many other products which may or may not succeed, which may or may not be a large part of the economy. Are you satisfied that government policy is keeping pace with this and providing the guidance, the infrastructure and so on within which companies can develop these products? And how do you keep up to speed on it?
So, Ivan McKee, the business minister, spends a lot of time in this space, as Michael Matheson, Net Zero Secretary, of course, is just back from Japan and Korea, speaking to a lot of large businesses over there who potentially might invest in Scotland. So, ministers are doing their best to engage with developing technologies and clearly we take expert advice. And we're publishing our policies. So, as I said, the hydrogen policy, for instance, we'll publish in the next few weeks, and that will take into account the latest research and technologies. So it's a challenge, but we have to work with the enterprise companies. We've got a really prestigious university sector and research sector in Scotland that's helping us as well.
Listen, let me take you on to a slightly different area. We all know what's happening with energy markets and the extraordinary increases in prices and the consequent increase in fuel poverty. And the prices are expected to continue to increase, I believe, through 2023. Has any assessment been done, or have you any feel as to the impact of the risk of fuel poverty on inequality in Scotland, and specifically, will it limit the ability of those impacted to secure improvements to energy efficiency methods or greener heating systems? What will the impact be? Have we any feel for that?
Ministers have been, as you can imagine, looking at this closely, and as you know, more support has been brought forward to help low-income households deal with their energy bills and tackle fuel poverty and home energy efficiency measures, etc. So yes, we are extremely concerned about the impact of rising energy prices and fuel poverty in Scotland and on rising inequalities in the country as well. I'm happy to ensure that you get some information followed up to committee about that, because there's a lot of work that's been taking place. And as I said before, the just transition will have failed if we find ourselves in a few years' time living in an energy-rich country, but people can't afford to pay their fuel bills. And we have people who are potentially dying from fuel poverty. You couldn't make it up. It's a horrendous situation. It shows that our energy policy in the past has failed. We, the energy market, energy regulation, reserved issues, the UK government, but we shouldn't be in this position where we're an energy-rich country and people are facing fuel poverty. So we have to get this right going forward, and the refreshed energy strategy, which the government's publishing shortly, will address some of these issues, as you can imagine.
Just on a specific issue, which actually affects my constituents, we obviously are encouraging people to invest in green heating systems such as solar in particular. And yet, when it comes to actual planning in my constituency, people living in conservation areas are routinely rejected in terms of their planning for solar panels, which seems ridiculous. And I wonder if there's a possibility the government might give some better guidelines and so on to councils in order to encourage the uptake of solar panels and other greener energy, because they're all just being rejected.
Well, thank you for the feedback of what's happening in your constituency. It's an important point. I know Patrick Harvey is working on this at the moment in terms of some of the measures and the obstacles that have to be addressed to decarbonise home heating. And so I'd be happy to ensure that your comments are passed on to him and he might respond to the committee or yourself directly about that. But yeah, that's just an example of the changes we have to consider moving forward.
Thank you.
Thank you. Before I bring in Jamie Harcourt-Johnson, the Minister will be aware of concerns around cuts to budgets for renewables within energy efficiency schemes. I understand it's to do with underspend within those budgets. So the money that goes to local authorities and money that is for energy efficiency schemes, that there is a cut in this year's budget. And as I said, I understand that's to do with an underspend. But what discussions are you having, and as somebody who is trying to deliver in this area, and we know from the Climate Change Committee's report this morning that housing and buildings is one of the weak areas where we need to see more progress, about how those funds can be retained within that sector, and we'll find a way, if they're being underspent, why are they being underspent, and try to resolve those issues, because we can't devalue the funding that was going. It is important that money is spent. How can we make sure in future that money is spent and that money is retained for important measures that need to take place in this area?
Yeah, I mean, the Scottish Government funds local authorities through the area-based schemes for retrofitting and these kind of measures in the renewable energy sector. So it's not necessarily directly the responsibility of the Scottish Government as to why that's arisen, and it may be over the course of the last couple of years there's been various factors that have slowed down some of those schemes being implemented. So I'd really have to come back to you to investigate what the reasons might be behind that. I'm happy to do that.
Okay, that might be helpful for the committee. Thank you. Katrina, would you like to come in?
Oh, I'm trying to press my buzzer. Right. So I think we're all in agreement that it's frustrating and needs to be changed how we have not been able to deliver against our targets. I mean, it's one of the areas where climate change and supporting people through the cost of living absolutely intersects. And it is, you're right, about demand rather than any actual cut to the budget. So recognising that in recent months, what colleagues in charge of the scheme have done is firstly to raise awareness. So there's now a campaign, a marketing campaign, to allow people to understand what they're entitled to. Secondly, increasing the amount of support that's given in terms of fuel poverty, so responding to the cost of living crisis, doubling some of the funds that are available to people who are least able to afford it, and also increasing the eligibility of the free service. So there's some strands which require people to lay down some of their own money to make the conversions, and there are other strands where through social housing, for instance, we're supporting people directly for free, and those have been increased. The other part is funding more energy advisors so that people can actually consult locally with what they're entitled to, rather than needing to navigate through the internet. And we have seen an uptake of of interest as direct result of those measures. I think looking forward, though, that the Minister mentioned before that there was a relationship between the 1.8 billion that has been dedicated to this and 33 billion that will actually cost the whole scheme over the next decade. And I think we need a new way of spreading that cost to make sure that we can actually deliver. So we're looking at regulations for when buying and selling happens on properties to make sure that we're actually accelerating the speed of the overall scheme.
Mm-hmm. And do you have any details of the timescale? You said you're looking at regulations.
I believe we're looking at regulations for 2024-25.
Okay, thank you. Jamie Harper-Johnson.
Thanks very much. Good morning. Before I come to my kind of main questions, I just wanted to ask around the hydrogen side. You've talked about, I think, 5 gigawatts of potential production, and I think you talked about 300,000 potential jobs. Where will hydrogen be used? Can you give us some detail on where it can actually be used within business, domestic?
So the government will be publishing its hydrogen policy in the next few weeks, and a lot of that information will be in there just now. I think there's various aspects of the hydrogen debate being looked at around Scotland. So, for instance, in the debate we had about CCS just a little while ago and the Acorn project, that's got a hydrogen element to it. And I think Grangemouth in particular are looking at that and how to produce hydrogen.
But I mean, that's production of it. Where will it actually be used? I mean, for example, could it be used in domestic boilers, domestic heating? What would it require to do that?
The UK government are in the next, I can't remember the exact timescale, they are about to take a decision in the next, I don't know if it's next year or so, on the role that hydrogen will play, and that'll have to guide us in Scotland, because that'll relate to the regulation. So that's going to have a big influence on where hydrogen could potentially be used in the economy. So we're waiting for that, because that's to do with the regulatory side of things. As I mentioned before, SGN are doing an exercise just in terms of the private sector on what it will mean for the gas networks and what potential it have for home use, domestic use. Yeah. So that's a potential route for it. And of course, we can see the hydrogen buses, which are being deployed in Aberdeen and creating some jobs up there as well. So transport's got a big role to play. And there's also an exercise going on in Scotland just now to do with the HGVs and the trucks, and how we can use hydrogen for that form of transport.
I'm very interested in hydrogen.
Yeah. No, I am as well. And if you go onto Twitter or any other social media, you'll see people ruling out certain uses for it and saying it should be using it. So there's a big debate going on about where hydrogen could best be
used. I mean, I suppose you know, we've talked about obviously domestic boilers being ruled out, and so people will be making decisions on, well, do we go to another form of renewables? But you know, if there's potential for domestic boilers to run, or you know, this is the difficulty. The kind of detail isn't there yet, and yet I suppose there's obviously a lot of people talking about potential within agriculture and other sorts of industries as well. I'm just interested because, as I say, I think there's a lot of lack of clarity, despite all the very positivity about it. And you know, you've talked about 300,000 jobs. It'd be good to know kind of where those might be.
That was in a statement that was issued. We can send you that. We sent that to committee. That was published a while back, looking at the potential for hydrogen, the hydrogen statement.
Okay, well, that would be helpful. I also wanted to ask around, you know, we've talked about the opportunities of just transition. You know, in previous kind of schemes like this or processes like this, you know, there's been a lot of opportunities for big business and less perhaps for some of the small, you know, SMEs basically to take advantage of it. So how can you ensure that SMEs are, you know, involved in taking advantage of the opportunities of just transition?
So both Net Zero Scotland and Scottish Enterprise, and the enterprise companies generally, are running schemes to help SMEs and small business take advantage of net zero opportunities. And there's a loan scheme run by Zero Waste Scotland for SMEs and Scottish Enterprise. And also Business Gateway are now sort of giving advice to small businesses about steps they could take for net zero as well. So there's a lot more has got to be done in this area, because you know, one vision I have is that we have to create a position in Scotland where, when I talk about just transition plans for sectors of the economy, place-based just transition plans for Grangemouth, and in 2024 we'll look at regional just transition plans for regions of Scotland. It's also a situation where we'd like every business in Scotland and every organisation to have its own just transition plan. So we need to work with the business community. And, you know, for instance, if you're a car mechanic business just now working in petrol and diesel, you know, we have to find a way of supporting businesses like that to have its own just transition plan, so that if petrol and diesel cars are going to be phased out in a few years' time, the business survives and people are still in work. So we have to work with the business community.
And you're meeting with the FSB, you're meeting with Chambers of Commerce, and are they raising any concerns with you over the approach that's being taken, or are they, you know, what is their kind of opinion?
I think from my conversations, the general acceptance that we have to raise awareness, you know, if you're a business, particularly in today's environment with, you know, rising energy costs and all the other challenges, labour shortages, that you're probably not thinking about your just transition plan or your net zero plan for the future. So how do we raise awareness and say this is really not only in your interests, but it's a new economic opportunity. You know, there's lots of opportunities for new companies to start up in areas. In my area, the small business that's going around homes putting in air source heat pumps, a private business, is overwhelmed with work. And I keep thinking to myself, well, it must be a business opportunity for lots of, either for that business to expand significantly or for new businesses. So we have to capitalise on economic opportunities. So yes, I have met all these organisations and okay. We'll continue to meet them.
Kind of a bit of going back to what we were talking about before, and my colleague Graham Simpson was talking about the transport side. Fiona Hislop asked you about, you know, the kind of the role you do in terms of within government. You talked about mainstreaming within government. You talked about kind of bilateral meetings with other colleagues. You're the just transition minister, but as just transition minister, do you see any conflict or contradiction between Scotland's, you know, meeting Scotland's climate change targets, targets around decarbonising, and also delivering on manifested commitments on, you know, some of the transport policies like road improvements, road upgrades, and obviously, you know, things like the A9 and the A96, which you'll be very aware of as the MP for Moray. Do you see any, let's say, conflict or contradiction between wanting to decarbonise but also meeting those commitments?
It's a really interesting question, because when we spoke earlier on about the challenges we face in the years ahead, and that kind of question gets to the heart of it, because the just transition is about not leaving communities behind. And, you know, we've got different situations around Scotland. So as we make the economic transformation, we have to be very careful to work out what lens we're looking at the just transition through. So, you know, there's no easy answer to that, because the just transition, on the one hand, is ensuring we achieve our net zero targets to reduce our emissions and our carbon footprint and, you know, play a role in the global effort to save humankind. But locally, as we do that, we have to take into account what it means for each individual community and indeed households. And we can't leave people behind. So you've got to balance all of that, and it's not easy.
So the just transition isn't, or meeting climate change targets isn't, as far as you're aware or concerned, a reason for not going ahead with these projects?
Just rephrase that, sorry, just say that question again.
So you know, as I suppose in terms of government delivering on these projects, the need for just transition, the need to hit climate change targets, isn't a reason for not going ahead with these projects?
Well, it depends how you deliver the just transition, because, you know, and I know where you're trying to go with this. MSP for Moray and the minister, but the just transition is different things to different people, and what matters is the outcomes. So if you have more equality, if you have good jobs and prosperity, that's the outcomes you want. So I can't sit here as just transition minister and say to a community, this is the answer for you of what a just transition means for you. That's why we co-design. And in the case of whether it's roads in one part of Scotland or another part of Scotland, we have to listen to communities. And, you know, what does a just transition mean to them?
Okay.
And it may mean a new road, or it may not mean a new road, it may mean something else. So we have to listen okay. to communities, and that's the whole purpose of co-design.
Okay, I've just got one very quick question on skills. You know, I've met with a number of organisations, a number of sectors recently, all talking about skills, yeah. all talking about delivering. You're talking here, about, as we said, about, I know you said it was mentioned in a previous report, but 300,000 jobs. You know, there's shortages across across various sectors, whether it's construction, whether it's aerospace and defence, whether it's parts of the financial services. How are we going to deliver these? How are we going to make sure we've got enough people to train up in these and that we're going to be able to deliver these jobs?
Yeah. So that's one of the questions, if there was to be a question that keeps me awake at night, apart from the impact of climate change, we don't deal with it, is in terms of our plans in Scotland, is the people and skills issue. Mm-hmm. And why is that a concern for me, and keeping, if there was one subject to keep me awake at night, why would it be this? Well, we're in a strange position just now in the labour market in Scotland, where we have low unemployment, but we have significant labour shortages, particularly in some sectors. Mm-hmm. And we have enormous, massive economic opportunities. I mean, the energy transition alone has the ability, if we get this right, to make Scotland one of the most successful economic countries in the world. But we need the people and we need the skills. And a lot of people say, oh, where are we going to get skills from? But I think you're right. I think some of the question is, where are we going to get people from? You know, so it's not a question of whether people have the skills. It's really, where are we going to get the people from? We've got demographic trends in Scotland. We've got no power over immigration policy. We've had Brexit. And this has tightened things up. And it's making this quite challenging, I think. So, I speak to companies about this all the time, and as you said, you know, every company mentions it to you. Some companies are confident they will get the people. If they get the go-ahead for X project or Y project, they're confident they will have the people to deliver that. And other companies are saying they've got vacancies. Mm-hmm. And I think we've seen Scottish Power and other companies saying we've got hundreds of vacancies in certain areas that we can employ people tomorrow to help the net zero transition if we had the people. So it's quite a varied picture out there.
Yeah.
One key concern I have is if you go back to, and I'm sorry to dwell on the CCS project, the Acorn project, it's just so frustrating if we've ended up with this. If we're not first mover, the skilled people leave. Mm-hmm. So you're getting feedback from the CCS sector now in Scotland and the UK that the UK government's taking so long with it, that a lot of skilled people go and work in America or other European countries that are going to go and race ahead of Scotland and CCS, or UK and CCS. So, you know, we can't afford to lose these people. We've got to be first movers and get going, because we'll lose thousands of skilled people. We'll just say, well, I'll just go and work over there. There's no job for me here.
I mean, it doesn't sound like there's going to be a shortage of jobs. And so, I mean, the point you make about Acorn is a point that's been made before by others of your colleagues, but it doesn't sound like there's going to be a shortage of jobs, because we're actually going to have a shortage of people. I suppose in your role as a former further and higher education minister as well, I mean, do you think the education system as a whole, through schooling, through further and higher education, is geared up enough to help ensure that young people go on those pathways to things like this, to the new emerging technologies, and to the other sectors we need? Are you confident that we're going to be able to deliver at least part of this through a system that is right and ready to provide the supply of jobs, people?
Yeah, I'm confident we'll make progress in that. I think there's a lot of work to do. I think it's now underway with the college and university sector. I was very encouraged by the Fraser of Allender Institute's report that was out in November, but the first event they had to talk about the report I was actually at, which was a net zero dimensional report called International Scotland, and they actually have a bit in there saying that Scotland's ahead in terms of green education courses than the rest of the UK. So there are good signs there that our system's gearing up, but I think there's a long way to go. Employers are now telling me that when people come, young people looking for work or applying for jobs or whatever, because they're actually looking for people, the young people are asking, what are you doing to tackle climate change? You know, mm-hmm. So employers are waking up to this. And so it's a sign that our young people want to go into those sectors or ensure that they're in the right kind of area and not playing a role in decarbonising Scotland and tackling climate change. So I think all these things hopefully will come together, and young people will want those jobs, will have the jobs, and we'll be able to train people for the jobs.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you. Minister, we had, I think, indicated it would be 11 o'clock finish. Are you happy to stay and answer a couple of other questions?
Yes. Time?
So thank you very much. Graham Simpson to be followed by Fiona Hislop.
Thanks for agreeing to stay on for a bit. I think just following up on that line of questioning, the Just Transition Commission said that there should be a skills guarantee for workers in carbon-intensive industries, and I think you committed to that as well. Do you think we're actually going to be in a position to offer that guarantee, and how would it look if there aren't the jobs? Maybe there are the jobs.
Yeah.
There are the jobs, but not the people.
Yeah. Well, as I said before, you know, we have a big challenge to make sure we have the people to realise our ambitions and the economic opportunities in Scotland. But we are working on ensuring people with the right skills and that the actual projects are delivered. So we're at this stage just now in Scotland where I think we're not far off the tipping points I mentioned earlier on. So the supply chain companies in Scotland are excited about the future, but of course they're waiting for the actual projects to happen, so they can keep people in work and stay in Scotland. And, you know, that's a big issue you find in North East Scotland, is that there's a lot of excitement, but they're just waiting for the fresh projects to come on stream. And that should hopefully happen. In terms of the skills guarantee, we know that there is a potential to employ even more people in energy, for instance, in North East Scotland than what we have at the moment. The Making the Switch report from RGU, which the government funded, found that we could actually create 9,000 more jobs in offshore energy in North East Scotland than what we have. So it's not just a case of protecting what we have, it's actually you can create more jobs. And we've funded through the Just Transition Fund nearly £5 million to OPITO, who is the offshore skills organisation, to create a digital passport to make it easier for people to use their transferable skills to move from oil and gas jobs into renewable jobs and decarbonised energy jobs. So it's looking optimistic at the moment, but clearly we know we've got to have the projects actually happening to deliver business for the supply chains and move forward.
Yeah, okay. I want to, if it's okay, Convener, just ask Katrina Lang something. Katrina, you mentioned earlier about regulations, and I think it was in relation to buildings. Now, in the last parliamentary session, we had the Tenement Maintenance Working Group, which I convened, because there are, you'll be aware there are huge issues with a lot of Scotland's properties actually getting agreement from owners to get work done, figuring out how that's paid for. So these were areas that working group looked at and produced some recommendations. It's now in the hands of the Scottish Law Commission. This is going to take years, actually, to resolve. So I'm interested in a bit more detail about what it is you're working on.
It's colleagues of mine that are working on it. I think what we're seeing, and has been mentioned before, is that at the moment the programmes are demand-led, but they're not moving fast enough. And so what we're looking at is regulations that would make certain conversions compulsory based on different trigger points. Now, this is early stage thinking, so I don't want to kind of describe too much what we'll end up with. But I think the bit about who pays is really important because, you know, when you're talking about converting a house completely from gas boiler to heat pump and insulation, you may be talking about £14,000.
Yeah.
And in the current climate, there are going to be, you know, the vast majority of Scottish people are going to find that extremely challenging to do. So what we need to have is a system where they're partially paid for by the public sector, but also support in terms of, you know, can you attach that to your mortgage, for instance, so that you're paying for it over a number of years and that it has a kind of nudge effect on the overall market in terms of the buying and selling price of the house. But I may already be going, you know,
too far
in terms of speculating about where we'll get to. I think the point is that we're signalling at this point that regulations will be a route to make sure that the overall programme is deliverable.
But yeah, I mean, I think that's really interesting. I would caution using regulations. If you do use regulations, they're going to have to be trailed in advance, because that's a very, very controversial area when you are essentially forcing people to spend money. Difficult to do, if not impossible.
I suppose Ms Lang's indicated it's an area of discussion,
yeah,
and
yes,
recognising what the issue is, they're still thinking through what the solution is. So, Fiona Hazel. Yeah,
I just wanted finally to ask about the Just Transition Commission, and if you could set out what your relationship is with them, how you work with them, and if you can provide evidence that you have already actioned some of the advice that they've been giving in their, obviously in their first report, but obviously in their current iteration.
Yeah, so clearly the Just Transition Commission is unique, and it's been encouraging to hear from other countries who've said to us they're, you know, impressed by the fact that we have a Just Transition Commission in Scotland. We've had quite a lot of good feedback from within Scotland about the people that are on it. Clearly it's to give independent advice to the government, but we do have a relationship. I've only met them, the new commission, once formally. And it's, you know, just in the last few months, and we'll be having much more intense engagement going forward, because we've been invited by the Commission to ask them for advice, you know, like, is there anything they can help us with? Mm-hmm. Because obviously they're looking at some of these big challenges, and they're very keen to know what our priorities are so they can give us the right advice. So it will intensify the engagement. We, of course, have accepted the recommendations from their two reports, and we'll respond to the second report and accept all the recommendations of the first report they've done. So it's a good relationship, and they'll hold our feet to the fire. That's why they're there. But I think they'll play a very constructive role as well to give advice, because if you look at the reports and what we've talked about today, there are no easy solutions or quick solutions to some of the issues we're speaking about. And we're doing this for the first time. So I think they recognise that. You know, hopefully we all recognise that as well as we go forward. So I think they'll play a very valuable role.
Thank you.
Is it? It's helpful. It's advice. Is it also? Do you anticipate them having a scrutiny role,
yes,
as well as,
yes,
advice? It's, and in terms of the accepting the recommendations from the first report, has there been, they've been accepted? What is there published information on how much progress has been made on delivering on those recommendations?
So we've had correspondence with the commission a couple of times. I think they asked us some questions and mm-hmm. to follow up, and we've responded to that. Okay. And the first report in particular was geared around many of the things we're speaking about today, which is the key principles underpin Just Transition and the sort of issues you have to address. So that's a very important first stage, that we do accept the principle of co-design. We do accept the principle of keeping a very close eye on people not falling behind or having to pay a disproportionate cost of the transition. So these general principles to get things going and set the parameters of what the Just Transition is all about is what the first report was about.
Okay,
so I'm sure the detail will come, and they'll press us more on the detail as time goes on.
Thank you. Just one final question, which you may feel has already been covered. The Scotland auction does have considerable pledges made to the Scottish supply chain, and we've heard from the engineering sector recently. So everybody's describing a situation where order books are full, they're just having challenges in delivering on the orders. Do you have already had a discussion around skills and people? Is there anything additional you want to say around that area about making sure the pipeline of work is clear for people and that they have the capacity to deliver?
So there's a lot of work going on in Scotland in this area, which is really important, because in terms of the big picture, as I said before, we have got really good companies that have perhaps grown out of oil and gas or other sectors in Scotland, and now they're looking to the future and thinking, right, we're now going to gear up for the green energy revolution, for instance, and they're all kind of gearing up for that, but they actually need the projects to happen. Mm-hmm. And some of those orders, I think, are now beginning to come to fruition. And the Offshore Energy UK, for instance, the trade body, they're mapping out the supply chain at the moment. And they're doing a really good exercise, which I think they're going to share with us shortly, and you may wish to, as a committee, speak to them, because it's a really crucial part, because so many of the jobs are in the supply chains. Mm. And if we want to get the just transition jobs, new industries, we need new supply chains. So that's all been mapped out by them in terms of the private sector. And of course, from a Scottish Government perspective, what we're working on is the local content agreements, the commitments from the £1.4 billion worth of business that's expected to come from each ScotWind bid, of which there are 20. So that's a lot of money for supply chains and for the Scottish economy. If we get a big chunk of that, we won't get it all, I'm sure, but we'll get a big chunk. But there's £1.4 billion from each project that could come to Scotland, if we manage to get that right. And finally, there's a collaboration space that the Scottish Government's pushing to bring the supply chains in Scotland together with the offshore wind developers. So they're all collaborating. Mm-hmm. And forging that close relationship before we get to the stage later on, so that we do capture more of the business. Mm-hmm. So that collaborative area is very important.
Okay, thank you. Do you have time to take an additional question from Jamie Hogwood-Johnson?
Sure.
Okay, thank you.
I thank the Minister for that. It's a really quick question. There's been an issue, certainly in Orkney, about a lack of meter installers, which is holding back house building, also smart meters, and not enough people to actually install smart meters, and that's wider than just... I was just wondering if that was something that had come across your desk, and whether there was, you know, what opportunity there might be for... you know, to be kind of involved in training more of those. As I say, I don't know if it's an issue that you're aware of, but...
It is an issue, and it's I've come across that in my own constituency, yeah. And I'm sure it's an issue throughout the Highlands, yeah, and Islands as well. So it is absolutely an issue, and we've started discussions both internally and with the further and higher education sectors. I think we've probably got a bit more work to do with the private companies, because... we are finding that private companies, the big players, you know, they're sending technicians and engineers up from the central belt, mm, to the rural areas, and they're less likely to do that if there's only a couple of jobs to do, because, you know, it's, yeah, travel, time, and it's obviously, ironically, a lot of the more fuel poverty, yeah, is in the north of Scotland, and it should be prioritised. So we have to make sure we're addressing that through a skill system and education system.
Okay.
And yeah, so there's a bit of work going on about that.
That's great. That's helpful. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Minister, for the evidence this morning. I do appreciate it's been quite wide-ranging, but
thank you
to yourself and to Katrina Lang for attending. I'll now move into a private session for the rest of the meeting.
Thank you very much.